But I share with Luca a passion. Passion for electronics, passion for technology, and also a passion for the humankind, you know, the humanity of Luca. And I think that we have everywhere, even if you do stranger things for most of the people on the planet, like electronic, if you value enough the human dimension and the capability to nurture talent around the globe, it's clear that we can apply our technology also to solve problems of the humankind. And maybe it's related a bit to the age. I like a lot to associate what we, as a researcher, even if I'm not young, but I consider myself still a researcher because I work a lot with the research community, what we can do together to do finally also something that will be good for the planet. And you see that in my presentation, I'm associating something like AI to the planet. Then this is a computing conference, and you may ask yourself why I talk about AI. We don't do only AI in my company, and I will not talk about my company anyway. But I wanted to take AI because it's clear to everybody that AI is one of the driving nowadays of the evolution of the computing society. And it's not the only one. Today, if you look, which are the kind of algorithm or application that are requiring computational power, one can be AI, the other can be blockchain. I wanted to focus on AI. They have something similar in terms of requests, but I will stay on the AI domain. And so why I'm talking about AI and the planet? You know, we are in the era of Internet of Things, and it's clear that Internet of Things has a sense if you had the possibility to use the data that we collect and to do something with those data. And this is where AI is coming on board. And I always like to compare the planet to a human body. A human body has the capability to sense, transfer the information somewhere centrally to the brain, elaborate the information, and then act. And when we talk about Internet of Things, we are talking about putting 50 billion devices around the planet, 50, 40, 30, you see many numbers. The key point is that you will have the capability to collect information in an autonomous way. You don't need, like in the first internet, human to put information inside. The central brain of the planet will have the capability to grab information by itself and then to do something with those information. And this is where AI comes on board. This is where high performance computing is coming on board. We are having a lot of data that are collected. Even if we talk about Internet of Things, remember, we are still in the first phase of Internet of Things. We are still in the first phase in many industries where we collect the data. And then we start thinking what we will do with those data. And here is where the computing of this data is coming on board. So imagine this planet, imagine this around the planet, how many good things you can do if you can better manage this planet. But anyway, I like to say, because the planet cannot be compared to a human, but it be compared to a robot, that in a way or another, we are robotizing the action around the planet. And we are just at the beginning. And there are something that can limit this possibility, and this possibility to use our talents. I'm sure there are many here in the room. We have probably the best talent in the field of computing. So how we can use this talent to do something that is really good for the problem of our planet. So, and I try here to list some of the problems on the planet. You see on the left side, energy. Energy is a scarce resource. All the environmental problems, like, you know, better controlling the planet, and collected to the problem of nutrition that is still a problem in the planet. Imagine on using this kind of technology to decide and to limit the usage of water when you grow plants. Imagine what you can do with this when you can control the catastrophic event in the planet and maybe anticipating. Here in Italy is a country of earthquakes. And there is a strange thing that always comes in my mind. I don't understand why semiconductor industry is always in a place where there are volcanoes. If you look around the world, we place the fab around the volcano. And this is an earthquake area, and we work in some micrometer. By the way, let's come back to the presentation. Let's say it's, you know, all those kind of things, if we think how we can use the technology, are really driving the evolution of the technology in a good way, in something that is good. And remember, every time there is a need of humankind, there is the possibility to have a success for the technology. I make always the example of the mobile phone. I was born in the generation pre-mobile phone. We didn't even know we needed a mobile phone. When somebody put in our hand a mobile phone, it was immediately a success, but why? It was responding to a human need. We love to communicate. We love to have information. Boom, the technology is success. So look how many good things we can do. There are also risks. They are on the right side of my presentation, but it's not something that, yes, of course, we have to be aware as a technical community, but related to the risk, there is the need to introduce regulation, and this is related to the politics and so on. And you see that also on that dimension, in European community and mostly everywhere, there are actions that start to be taken also to address the right part of my presentation. But now let's move on the technical part of the presentation. So we have to robotize the planet. And I told you we are at the beginning. We have to do something more if we want really those technologies to be available to solve this kind of thing. And let's see some of the challenges. We can save, we can improve the use of the energy. You can, for example, the energy of your house, you can control through a cloud control. But if to save 1 kilowatt in your house, you will dissipate 1 megawatt in the cloud, you didn't solve the problem. You simply has created more problems. And you see the forecast, one-fifth of the energy consumption in the planet will be driven by data. So, we have to do something to improve in the processing of data, to improve the efficiency on top of the performance that we do. We have elaborated another example working with one of our customers that is working in the field of predictive maintenance. And I give you this example to control a machinery that is, we can simplify as a motor, data extracted from the motor. If you transmit all the data, you can easily transmit 30 gigabyte per day for one machinery. Imagine how many machinery you have in the planet. It is clear that if you can better automate a factory, you will have better results in terms of pollution, in terms of energy consumption, and all of this. So there is something to do on this. Another application, so this is data that we found, the forecast of Google. If every Android user will use 3 minutes of speech recognition, speech recognition has done a big evolution over the last year. We will have to double the computing resources around the planet. Privacy. Here I can tell you a personal example. I bought an Alexa device for my wife. She had in the living room this Alexa device. At the beginning, she was enthusiastic about that because she was asking music, was playing the music she wanted. She did a voice interface, was fantastic. One day, Alexa turned on by itself. What my wife did, he asked me, so how does it work, this device? She is not an electronic engineer. It's completely the opposite. It is let me say, technology adverse. Just, and this is probably why I'm married since a long time with her. And so I explained, when she understood that the recognition was done in the cloud, she turned off Alexa. Now is in a room where she just listen music, and she started to use the computer when she wanted to do something. One day I will explain her that also when she uses the computer anyway, there is someone that is checking everything that she's doing. But privacy can be one of the limitation of really using the way we said this technology. And for us that are in the industry, there is also some challenges that is related to the market. When you serve an IoT-driven market, you have to serve electronic to many differentiated applications. We are very happy when we serve the mobile phone industry. There are 5 players in the planet. They ordered you millions of components, but when you have to serve many small players, is another challenge. You have to make your technology easy to use. To make it easy to use, you have to do more. It's not enough to pick in silicon, you have to give software, you have to give AI algorithm. In the case of AI, you have to give more. To make it used, to have really the deployment. And the challenge is there. When I'm telling you that thanks to this wave, many new actors are coming in the field of electronics, I want just to show this slide. This is clear that when we are talking to AI, it can pervade from too many business fields that are not just the pure electronic. You go to too many applications. And it's clear that this is changing the market dynamics. And this is what is pushing the industry to focus to this field. The market is there. There are needs for the humankind, but there is also industrial need to go in this market. And what is fantastic, I think, for this community of computing, that AI has a lot of challenges from the computing point of view. And let's look which are the industry field that can sustain this evolution. You see, we were talking about transmitting data, and you see 5G is coming in the picture. And 5G is responding to one of those needs, increasing the bandwidth, and in particular, from the technical point of view, reducing the latency. Latency can be one of the obstacles to implement this kind of robotization on the planet that I described you at the beginning of the speech. So, telecom industry, and they are investing a lot to do that. I'm sure they would like to have the revenue from the investment. It is clear that this market will have also a market-driven push, not only a need that is eaten, but there is also a push from an industry that has invested. And if you look to the next enabler, that is the cloud industry, you know how much the big giants are investing in all this kind of technology. They are brutal in this investment. You look to Google, Amazon, Alibaba, those players, they are brutally investing. And for them, which is the challenge, they would like everybody to use this technology. The challenge also there is to make easy to use the technology. And they are doing a lot of investment to make it to use. And the other industry, if we want all this distribution of sensor, is of course the battery industry. It's an important industry for this evolution. You see immediately in the car, for me, if you talk about Internet of Things and artificial intelligence, the car is probably the best example of Internet of Things object that you can use to collect a lot of data. And the electric car without a battery, efficient battery, is an industry that would have started. And all the evolution that we start from there will be deployed to the rest of the industry. It's clear when the technology is coming. And everybody will benefit. So those will help on this. And of course, the last one is semiconductor industry. And so it's clear, it is our nightmare. We are always contributing to this kind of evolution with lower lithography, decreasing the cost, improving the performances, and all this kind of thing. And so the last part is the part where I will focus more, coming from this industry. And it will be covering the rest of the speech. But I wanted to start giving you, first of all, a larger picture. So those industries are simply contributing to do this. So what I put in the first slide, then having AI distributed everywhere. But And where we are on AI, let me touch the dimension of perception in the field of AI, and let's see what was happening up to 2015, 2016, 17. In terms of algorithm, I take the example of imaging. AI, now what the machinery is capable to do, it can have performance that are even superior to the performance of the human. But what is behind to that? If we look up to 2016, more or less, what has been, in particular using the CNN kind of algorithm, the computational power that was needed was exploding. And I said at the beginning, this may go against our idea to use this kind of technology to better improve the performances of what is happening. So this is what was happening up to 2016, more or less. I may be right or wrong, 1 year, more or less, on that. But then what is the challenge, if it is true, that we have in front of us? And then you start understanding the part of the title of my presentation. Yes, computing AI, but in a more efficient way. I think this is the real challenge, because if we want to bring this technology really deployed and giving the advantage that we would like to do, now we have to start thinking about efficiency and not only performance. Performance, we have demonstrated what AI can do. Now, if we want to deploy, efficiency is our challenge as a computing community. And I'm sure, and on this I will show in the rest of the presentation, that we really can do a lot for the deployment of this kind of technology. And it's normal. It always happens in any new sector of electronic. At the beginning, you want to demonstrate that your technology can do. And then when you have to deploy, you start working on the way to making it more performant, low cost, and the damnation, whereas in semiconductor industry, we are always decreasing the cost of the technology. So let's start looking at it from the perspective of the cloud. Also in the first slide, the algorithms, let's call them algorithms, or maybe machine learning or a network. So my video in the presentation will make also some confusion in the use of the term, but I think it's the concept that I would like to pass to you. It's clear that there is a time now from performances to efficiency, and it's something that needs to be done. In terms of architecture, so you know all of this, and this is where, by the way, is very common with blockchain. Most of the implementation has been done on GPU. And now, what is the trend of the big player? They have their dedicated processing element that is using hardware acceleration. You see, an industry that has most of its bill that is based on energy, that is the cloud industry, in the P&L, I'm not saying about investment, that is another, but they're focusing on this area. They need machines that are more efficient, and then they are starting to introduce hardware acceleration. Architecture that are more neural network optimized to do this kind of process. Next generation, probably neuromorphic. And when you think to neuromorphic, it's clear that one of the barriers that you start thinking how to destroy is the memory barrier. And we know, all of us know, that this kind of computing is needing a lot of data, is need a lot of coefficient, so memory is an important part of the system. Then there is other technology that are needed to optimize, like silicon photonics, because cloud is just moving data between different processors in a virtualized platform, but it is not part of this presentation, it's another trend. Not by chance you see how much interest now there is in silicon photonics in the industry. And the photonics for a period of time was mostly forgotten. And in fact, from 2016, 17, something was changing, even in the algorithm. You start having algorithms that without losing performance, are focusing on efficiency. And you see, and what can we expect from algorithms? If what we see today is that probably you can improve one order of magnitude, you see those numbers, so the scale probably is not appropriate, but you are in one order of magnitude of decreasing computational power. Then you start optimizing your network, so probably you will lose a bit the regularity of your network, but at the end of the day, you start saving one-tenth, decrease it by 10 times the kind of computational power that you need. It means that you can run 10 times more inference, for example, in parallel, or that you will dissipate one-tenth of the energy. So it's a good gain. And you see, the industry, the start, and probably the push even on the research, I'm not an expert in the software dimension, but probably the push also in the research now is to move in this dimension. Some ideas, so probably in the future we will use AI to optimize AI. So AI to, in the neural network domain, to optimize the architecture of the network, to prune the network, to decrease the number of coefficients, and to decrease the number of connections. Another important point, and this is always the dilemma of computing, you start centralized, then you distribute, and you go back centralized, and then you distribute, and you go back centralized. Is distributed computing. So today, when we talk to artificial intelligence, we talk about a model where you have sensor, grab the information, you put in the cloud, you collect in the cloud, and you elaborate. It's not sustainable. It's simply not sustainable. If you want really the deployment, now we have to start thinking how we can really deploy the AI processing along the end-to-end chain, because the system we are talking about are all systems that are connected. So you have the challenge of the data, you have the challenge of the bandwidth, you have the challenge on the process. If you can better distribute the process, it's clear that you can do a jump. You can think to have the perception that probably is in the node or in the gateway, and having the reasoning that is done in the cloud. I will show you in the presentation which kind of advantage. And this will overcome the problem of energy computation that is needed and will destroy a barrier to the big deployment to that. I'm not an expert in software, but what is needed to do that, and is already on the way, for example, when we talk about event-driven kind of software development, is in cloud has done a big jump virtualizing the computing platform in a server or or around the planet. So now the challenge, if we want to distribute in a transparent way the processing of computing in general, but AI in particular, we have to start understanding how to do an end-to-end kind of virtualization. And the big players on the cloud are already looking around this concept. So in such a way, in a seamless way, you properly distribute the processing along the chain. And so in this slide, I had to put and there's some of the limitation of the current model that is just cloud-centric, so the big data center is the scalability. I said an end-to-end architecture where you can better distribute the computing. And if you look, cloud was the first answer to the scalability on the server side. Now, the next step is to extend the scalability on the end-to-end platform. In computing, it's not something new. It has always happened. Start center and then distributing. Then latency, of course, if you are driving a car, you cannot have your object recognition that is running on the cloud, to give you an example. The bandwidth. I said how many data we are seeing, how many data we have to transmit. The privacy. If the Alexa or my wife, I would have explained that if, their command and everything was recognized in the node, and just it was like the earth to type in the cloud the request that she wanted, probably my wife wouldn't have removed, as I told you at the beginning, Alexa from the living room. And all the things that probably you saw here, you know much more than me. And distributed AI is an advantage, and someone can call it for computing, you know. But anyway, distributing has all disadvantages, and but probably I don't have even to spend time in describing that. You all know it has always been the paradigm of the computing at a certain time. You develop central, you come with algorithms that are super powerful at the central computing, and then at the end of the day, you understand that it's better you distribute if you want to have the real deployment. On this, let me just focus on two things. Thinking to processing of artificial intelligence on two dimensions, the perception and the reasoning, is clear that if you are capable to give the perception to the node and to the gateway, like in the human body, and you can focus on the reasoning centrally, this can be a big improvement in terms of many things, security, for example. But there are also clear industrial needs that are pushing this direction. I show you the example at the beginning of the predictive maintenance. So nobody will accept a stop of a fab because there is a moment where there is a loose connection. What you do in the fab for energy, usually you have a system that are capable to supply you the power in the case there is problem on the power connection. The same is if we deploy this vision when you write the line. If you are disconnected to the cloud, you would like to your line to continue to work. Like when you are disconnected from the main and you want your machinery anyway with your autonomous supply system to continue to work. Imagine in a surgery room in an hospital, if you want to have an example, not in industrial, for this kind of need. So there is a real push for the industry to go in this direction. And so I want to mention this, but I will not talk apart the end a few words about ST, but I mention a paper, I'm not mentioning a product. I never mention product when I do keynote at the conference. So this is one of the examples on how to the computing, using properly the hardware acceleration, we can improve the efficiency of our AI implementation. This is something we have done with our technology, demonstrating in R&D, it's not a product, 3 TW per watt as a power. And in particular, just to give you an example that is more numeric, that I like more, we have been capable to do image recognition in 20 milliwatt with the same kind of network that running on a GPU was running at 20 watt. So we demonstrated that you can easily gain up to 3 order of magnitude or better efficiency in term of power and even also in term of dimension, because you know that thanks to this acceleration. So we said from an algorithmic point of view, we can gain 1 order of magnitude probably with acceleration then. Computing machine that are more dedicated in particular to this was in particular focus on the neural network, you can achieve up to 3 order of magnitude. Maybe if you are good, I think here we have excellent designer in this room, you can even do more. Then the next step that I was mentioning, and this is the one that being an engineer I like most, and having been involved in design, is the move toward neuromorphics. this is really interesting, because it's like if you... So far, when we were thinking about computing or processing more in general, we've been always thinking about digitalization and then using brute force. When you start talking about neuromorphing, it's like if you take your toolbox of designer and you start using everything that you have available. A different way to use the memory, a way to merge analog and digital in a different way. The way you overcome the classical von Neumann architecture. So it's a fantastic field for research, no? And it's something that can give the next generation, the improvement also for the deployment of this technology. So it's fantastic. There is also some challenge because here we're mentioning the result of an European project, by the way, and that is very interesting from my point of view in this perspective. There is also some challenges that is coming to the industry because you start thinking to something that is in the field of approximated computing. And so when I go to the people in my fab, they will tell, so how can I check this device? How can I verify this device? How you can guarantee that this device is working? And probably this on the, and there are a lot of challenges that, you know, where we need a lot of research, a lot of work to really understand how to handle this, that, you know, for this, you can easily achieve 4-5 order of magnitude improvement in terms of efficiency, and even more, it depends the way they will do. And there is some challenges. We had many in the past of challenges. I'm sure we will solve this challenge. And the other thing, that my technician that is sitting there and explaining to me that in particular when you process AI, you are more resilient to the error that you may have in your chip in terms of coefficient and so on, like a human body, no, at the end of the day. And, very interesting, I think. So this is very exciting. We'll take step, but I'm sure if this can give an advantage, the market will be there. And then when the market will be there, the needs will be there, probably this technology will be applied. And so if we do that, we come back to be more generic. I don't like to go too much in detail. So at the end, this is what we will realize. You know, we have everything connected with the capability to collect information. And when you collect information from a fleet of different devices, you start creating the second level of knowledge and you can start creating new services. And I always like to mention agriculture. So imagine what you can do in this field, the way we are probably not well using the planet resources in this field. If you're able to give the right drop of water, to use the right level of fertilizer and all the chemistry that is used in that. So imagine. So this is what we can do. But to do that, we will have really to solve the problem and deploying the capability of having knowledge that is distributed to all these devices. Then, when we say this kind of example, it comes in my mind, robots and robotic industry. I think that we start having really already the right toolbox in such a way on industry of sort of humanoid, let's call it this way, or robot used for assistance can become a real big market like the automotive at the beginning of the last century. Now probably we are at the beginning of preparing the technology for another interesting object that will can reach of our life like a robot. But even if you don't look at the robot, you look on the right side. When we are talking about an electric car with a self-driving capability, so it's not far to be a robot. So we are not only robotizing the planet, we are robotizing the single object that are in the planet. So drones and surgery, for example. How much, in particular for surgery in the brain, now the electronics is really assisting the way this is done. So there are many applications, even in the object, where the capability to bring this kind of technology in inside the device is becoming very important. But I would like you to put attention on this point. If we realize this concept of really distributing the capability to do this kind of processing, we are moving in a direction on the global cognitive computing. You can, and I put the robot as an example, maybe exaggerating, you can learn at the periphery, you can transmit what you learn in the cloud, you can make the synthesis of what you are learning, and then you can retrain your periphery machines. And this is bringing a good improvement on the thing. And there is something that will be possible. There are some barriers to solve, but in a proper distribution what we do, it's clear that this is something that that can be done. Normal question in all those cases is about the human. I'm looking to the watch because I don't want to explode my time. I like a lot to talk with the technical community because I really think that we are in the age where engineers, that so far has done a lot of technology that has done also bad thing to the planet, pollution, all this kind of thing, can do something now that can be very useful for the planet. So let's talk a bit about the human, so ourselves. And I was mentioning before, voice interface, so I don't know how many years, I think more than 20 years ago, we were focusing on voice recognition, all this technique, how to recognize voice and so on. Always available, a failure, not accepted as a user interface. And now you see, you start applying, you start having the capability to collect more data from a community of people, to put in a central place, to apply artificial intelligence technique, you start improving in the semantic recognition, and now is an interface that is acceptable. We change and is exploding the use of these kind of devices. I think till 10 years ago, you know, I had probably the first voice recognition system in the car. After 2 days, I turned it off because it wasn't understanding anything in the past. Now, you know, the problem is evident. Is this the combination of all this technology? But this is also creating the challenge that I described at the beginning. And in a future world, voice is just the beginning. It's just the beginning of that. You can imagine how the human-machine interaction can really evolve in this dimension. And we start introducing the concept of the virtual reality that is in terms of processing has a lot of challenges. If you want something wearable that is intelligent, it cannot dissipate a couple of what if you put in on your brain. So it's something that has to be reasonable in terms of cost and so on. And we are moving in this direction, and we start having technology in terms of sensor that give the capability even to collect emotion. And emotion you collect combining information that are coming from different sources. Temperature, it can be camera, it can be heart rate, all technology that we are available. So we are starting to change the way we are interacting with this big machine that I was describing before that will be distributed around the planet. Also ourselves, we become a sort of object. In the past, more or less in a voluntaristic way, we put our data on the social network. And you look at the explosion of that, and now you start putting data even in a not voluntary way, because you accept and you forget and you do. And then imagine where you can also transmit or sensor on top of you your data to the cloud, what this can create. And you know, also here, even in the localized way, the capability to have the two dimension of the perception and the reasoning that are related to the big range of what we can call AI, we simplify as AI, as a name, is becoming important. Ourselves, for example, we are starting to put much machine learning capability inside the sensor. Now a motion sensor has already inside the capability to do the perception dimension. Or a camera, we will see camera that has already the recognition that is inside. And then even a simple microcontroller, not even talking about microprocessor, simple microcontroller can do the next level if properly combined. And this will allow to have this kind of technology that are really deployed, and they are doing the little knowledge and understanding locally. And I was putting this example looking at the body, but can do on anything. And I remember at the beginning my representation of the evolution of the technology, like a human body where you have sensing, or even our capability to sense is not a stupid sense, it doesn't transmit all the data to the brain. There is local computing. Because when you touch something that is hot, you react, the brain doesn't have this speedy reacting. So you're, when you touch something hot, you are like a car that has to in front of an obstacle. And so and the technology is going there, are going exactly in this direction. And so let me give another example. We are talking about social network. You see the trend in the industry? Is there? Look at the recent acquisition for Facebook. There is a lot to do here, by the way, to do that. So it's we can call it the deep edge in this case. And also there, social network is something that didn't exist 15 years ago. This is also becoming moving to the, I'm sure it will move to the next generation, what we call cognitive social network. And I like to call it Life 2.0. I know there is some startup that is already looking to this kind of concept. Imagine a network where on top of the information that you put inside, will be able also, social network, to collect your emotion anytime you do a reaction, and then to combine your emotion to the information you put or to the reaction that you have. You start a little bit creating really a twin of yourself in the cloud. At the point where one day I may die, I hope 100 years from now, and maybe my child can ask me to what I have virtualized in the network, some consultancy or something, and probably may have an answer that is very close to the one that I would have given to him. Not probably the same, but probably something close. So imagine this interaction, what it can bring. Is this good or not? I have no idea. And so a provocation now to all of us. We are getting close to the final of the presentation, so don't worry, I'm on time. How our job will evolve? Most of you are software, hardware designer, or researcher, or so how will this evolve? Imagine in most of your activity, you are interacting with a system that is capable to absorb information from you and giving you also some cognitive support in the thing that you are doing. So we are moving in the direction of the cognitive design. Imagine for the hardware designer how much time we spend in the final phase of the design, the verification and all this stuff. How many of those things an expert system learning from us and learning from many of us doing the same action around the planet can improve and assist us in doing that. We are already introducing this kind of techniques, for example, in the manufacturing where we have a computer that is learning from the operator and step by step is helping the operator to act better. It will happen also in our job. I'm more expert in the hardware design than in the software design, but I've been showed just yesterday that there are already startups that even in the way to write the software, they give you AI assistance on the way to write the software. So it may come a normal question even for us. If we are creating something that is in competition with us. Because we are moving our knowledge and we are putting together in a collective way the knowledge in a machine that is capable to exploit this collective knowledge. And this is what when we talk about in work with all in a company is what we do thanks to the scientific community, the capability to share information, to have the way to move to the level to the next level, and is what those technology will allow to do. Anyway, if we look to the last century and the thing that we've been capable to do, in the last century, all the evolution of the human progress and the scientific evolution has been driven by computing support. I don't think we could, in my industry, put in a chip millions and millions of transistors if we would have had to buy it, if we wouldn't have the improvement on the computational support. And we have done fantastic things thanks to that. And so probably what is the next century, we start to have a different kind of support that will be a cognitive support. This is the challenge that we have in front of us. And the progress of everything that we will do, I cannot even imagine, which is the speed of the progress of what we can do thanks to that. And let me give you an example in another field, medicine. Imagine how medicine can improve when a doctor will have available as a support when he had to do a diagnosis, the synthesis, because the cognitive way is to give the synthesis and the experience that is coming from the diagnosis of millions of doctors in the planet that has been working on billions of patients in the planet. It's clear that the diagnosis will be much better. It's clear that the way this job will be done will be different. And this will touch also our job. And so with this, I'm mostly at the end of my presentation. Allow me only two or three slides talking about this company, about my company. I will not, it will not be an advertising set of slides, but I would like to explain you why we have this big attention on doing things that at the end will be helpful for the social and the human life. So we have a semiconductor company. For the people that doesn't know ST Microelectronics, I don't describe anything in this slide. Like, you know, results are 2018, not 2019, because it's not yet official. But in 2018, we growth 15%. We growth more or less in the last 2 years, twice of the rest of the industry. One of the reasons of this growth was the strong focus on the kind of technology that I described to you. Car, electrification, IoT, and even artificial intelligence in the node, and all the computing that is needed to deploy the technology on the node. So you see my presentation, we have historically a strong commitment to sustainability. Our most remembered CEO, that was Pasquale Pistorio, was one of the first to invest to be carbon free as a company and to invest in Amazonia to build trees. So sustainability for us is important, and everything I told you is our part of the contribution that we can do on sustainability, making technology available to do a better planet and to solve some of the problems on the planet. That can be pollution, it can be energy saving, it can be human life, it can be assistance to robotics. There are many other things that we can do. But we have to do the jump, so there are lots of things to do that. And the other thing, and this is the reason why I'm here, this is the reason why I like to talk to you about our challenges and to share with you our vision, but also what we think to do good. We need research. We need the shared research, we need the European project, we need the collaborative, we need the academia, we need ideas are everywhere. Talent are everywhere in the planet. We have a strong community in Italy, but we are really open to innovation from everywhere in the planet. And we need that. So for us, innovation is not an option, but it's something that is important, because if you want to realize those kind of things, I told you about neuromorphic and the challenge that is fantastic scientific dimension, the challenge that I behind, we need you to do that. And so I finish with this slide. I like to look to my company as an innovative company with we can valorize talent, but with a strong attention to create a better future for all of us. And with this, thank you to all of you.